Do you want to make some cool visuals effects for your games? For most games, you don't need to think too much, but if you want some cool lighting effects or to make a nice looking 3D game or some post-processing effects or stylized art, you would need at some point learn the rendering pipelines. I can't say it's easy, but who said it would be? The whole game development process is very complicated, but this video will try to explain rendering in the most basic words possible and will gradually dig in deeper, so hopefully this knowledge will let you understand not only specific aspects of the chosen game engine, but the whole process used similarly in most of the engines and frameworks out there. So let's overcome the fear of getting into rendering by diving into the heavily inspired by OpenGL rendering pipeline. Render pipeline is a whole process of making your visual components visible on a screen. But don't worry, modern frameworks and game engines simplify the process. For example, Defold takes care of a tremendous amount of stuff that is needed for each pixel to be displayed on different devices. You can interact with rendering on some very top layer, but also have the possibility to dig in to achieve really cool things. Render pipeline answers three crucial questions: what to render, where to render, and when to render. By answering them one by one, you will see the whole picture. In default, what to render is defined by render predicate, a kind of group of visual components. Where to render is defined by the view of the game's world through some kind of projection, like you would see the world through a camera but on a flat screen. And finally, when to render is controlled by the render script. So what you can render? Simply all visual components, but additionally in default you can group them. You can use the mentioned render predicates for this. Those are kind of filters allowing you to control what to render on screen. Visual components like, for example, sprites, tile maps and 3D models are all rendered on screen separately. GUI nodes are drawn separately on screen, or even some debugging lines and texts. You can create more such predicates to control what you are drawing. For example, you can disable drawing GUI at all. You can enable drawing lights or 3D models separately. Such groupings give you more control over where and when you will be rendering different visual components. So imagine render predicates as just names, tags, filters in materials for each visual component. Material? Yes, each visual component has a material assigned to it. Material is a nice abstraction defining how to render a given component and thus answering part of the question where to render. How? Because it defines special programs, also called shaders, that define how given geometry will be rendered. So where you would see components looking at the game's world through camera, seeing some kind of view and projecting this view on your flat screen, and then, after rasterization, which I will explain later on, where to draw each pixel on screen. There are a lot of concepts in a few statements, so they all need to be explained. But before this, we'll focus more on the last question. When to render? This is defined in default in render script, the heart of the render pipeline, which describes the whole process of producing frames on screen. This is one and only script in default that defines the whole rendering process. Take a look at your game.project. Two most important things are in one tab: the main collection that will be loaded at start of your game, and the special render file, which contains simply two informations: the render script and the list of materials that could be used in it. That's all. But before we analyze the render script, let's imagine how we produce pixels on our screens. Imagine each visual component in your game as a bunch of triangles. Even for 2D sprites, those could be drawn on two triangles forming a rectangle. It's easy to imagine when looking at polygons in 3D models or a synthwave retro graphics. There's much mathematics involved behind it because the graphics are calculated in a few steps. Each triangle consists of three lines connecting three points. Those points are called vertices. Each vertex is a point, a coordinate in 3D space. So one of the first steps in graphics pipelines are regarding operating on those coordinates, those vertices. So the program making calculations on those is called a vertex program or a vertex shader. Graphics cards are powerful in such calculations and don't even sweat making complex matrix operations on millions of points. After all those overwhelming calculations, we have a nicely defined 3D geometry. There are a few important but more complicated steps in between, but at first imagine you only get those triangles somehow and everything is very simple, and you get all this data projected into a flat screen to finally get you to the point of rasterization. And this is simply a slicing all this geometry into small pieces very well known as pixels. For each of those pixels, at the end we need to assign a color. So each diode on your device could be lit according to this and as whole form a frame. A color of each pixel is described as a mix of a given amount of red, green and blue colors and additional transparency value. Graphics cards perform calculations for each pixel, a tiny fragment on your screen utilizing a fragment program, also called fragment shader. At the end, some additional work could be performed by the graphics engine, which goes through some tests and blending stages. Are you with me? Could we go deeper into how those 3D triangles are actually projected on a flat 2D screen? There are a bunch of steps to transform each point in 3D into a point on a 2D screen. So we would go through them and name the steps and the coordinate systems that are produced after each of them. First, we have a primitive example geometry, let's say a 3D cube, which could be described with 8 points in 3D space. When you make such a cube in, for example, Blender, it will be created in its local coordinate space, and all points will be described in such a coordinate system. So each visual component in 3D games has their own local space, but you want all those objects to be put into our game world. So they need to be included in some common global coordinate system, the world space. You have a model matrix in between that converts local points on our 3D cube and each other model to the world coordinate system. We won't analyze the mathematics behind it, but you might note that multiplying data by special matrices allows us to convert translations and rotations to different coordinate systems, and this is what this model matrix is for. So when you have all the data in one world space, you then watch the world through the lenses of the camera or the player's virtual eyes. What you see is depending on where the camera is and at what it is pointing, right? So it's the view of the camera, and so such a view has its own coordinate system, whose origin is commonly located at the middle of the view. To convert the world space coordinates to view space, you perform a calculation with view matrix. So the view matrix is really describing your in-game camera. For example, in first-person shooters, you can feel how directly you rotate the camera around. And in 2D games, you usually can't rotate the camera, but can move it around showing different pieces of the world. But defining only a view is not enough. We can't see like the game's camera in three dimensions, because we need to somehow project this view to flat screens. We do this using a special matrix called projection matrix. And this step converts view space to a so-called clip space. It is a projected view of what the camera sees, and it's called clip because all the coordinates that are outside such a projected view area are clipped and not shown on screen. Remaining coordinates will end up as fragments visible on screen, and what's funny, when some triangles on the edge of view are cut in half because of such clipping, the graphics engine automatically creates new triangles on the edges to actually fit inside and fill the whole screen. Finally, such a clipped view is then very quickly converted into another convenient space, which is a screen space, with its origin commonly in a corner of the screen, and this is done with the use of a viewport matrix. You don't need to actually always use the whole screen making full screen games, but you can draw everything in a window that could have different dimensions, and this is exactly what the viewport is for. You define the dimensions of a rectangular space on which you will be drawing all your pixels. Okay, another level of diving in. We barely mentioned how the pipeline projects the 3D view to a flat screen, but you might be aware that there are different kinds of projections. Each projection could be defined by a special 3D shape, a sliced lump, or most simple cuboid, or even a cube, called professionally frustum. It has two important sides, called near and far planes, that are actually parallel to the screen, and the rest of the sides just connect them. A special, very simple kind of projection, such that near and far planes have the same area, is called an orthographic projection. Its name is because the lines describing the view then are orthogonal to the view plane, so the frustum is a simple cuboid. So effectively you don't scale 3D objects to screen like you think the objects far away from you are perceptibly smaller than the ones closer to you, but see them in a way that imaginably are far, far, infinitely far away from you, but you have an eagle sight. Orthographic projection is commonly used in 2D games because it's simple, very clear, and because you have flat sprites that don't look good in perspective projections. Yeah, I mentioned it without explaining, but very easily you imagine that perspective projection is an opposite. It's an effect where you see objects far away from you actually smaller than the ones close to you. It's very useful for 3D games because it really is corresponding to our actual perception, to how our eye see. In such projections, the lines connecting the near and far planes are actually meeting at one point in space, and an angle between them is called field of view. This angle for realistic projection, like our eyes work, is usually around 45 degrees, but it's maths, and nothing stops you from making field of view of 60 degrees even. Like in Doom games, it will be kind of deformed, but you will let players see more on a flat screen. All those coordinate systems are, by OpenGL convention, right-handed, because, well, take your right hand and look at its inner side with all fingers pointing up, in the positive direction of the y-axis. Let your thumb point to the right, to the positive direction of the x-axis, and bend some of your fingers to the front of you to point in the positive direction of the z-axis. You might at some point take advantage of such knowledge, so thank me later. That really is a lot of information for one video, so for even more thorough explanations, I invite you to check out Learn OpenGL website, where Joey explained in the most affordable and detailed way how OpenGL works. And I mentioned OpenGL a few times already without saying what it is, because it's not so simple, it's not a language, it's not an implementation of rendering, it's just a specification, a standard describing how functions should communicate with graphic cards to produce desired results. It's generally the graphics card manufacturers that implement drivers for this. And game engines are usually an abstraction of using raw OpenGL functions, morphine or less, but in the end they simplify this. Default is running on OpenGL and therefore its render pipeline is heavily influenced by OpenGL workflow. But thanks to offering such an abstraction layer over OpenGL, the underlying renderer could be replaced and for example many engines, including Default, also offer support for Vulkan and WebGL render pipelines. Such possibility is crucial to support different devices because, for example, Apple devices use Metal, while HTML5 builds run on WebGL. But you don't care about it, it's a job of Default. You build one rendering pipeline and could release on many platforms simultaneously, and that's what makes a game engine multi-platform. You will find a similar approach in most of the engines. Community is also fiddling with renderers and, for example, there is a possibility to make a game in Default but with a RayLib renderer. For now, please digest the amount of information provided here, and in the next video we will dive into the render script of Default. And by the way, if you want to help creating such videos, leaving a traditional like, a comment and subscribing to my channel with this ding-dong ringing helps me be encouraged to continue and make more videos. And for even more support, I already run Patreon, Ko-fi and soon GitHub sponsors, so you know, my kind of piggy bank for future is there. Have a nice day and see you soon!